sunrise jaunt safari. We're driving into what can only be described as a post-apocalyptic sunrise. My name is James Hendry. On camera today is Brian, the thumb Joubert. Brian, just a suited thumb today.
A very chuffed suited thumb.
A chuffed suited thumb. Very nice. Our plan for the morning, and we're as live as Jamie is, believe it or not, is to head towards the east here. We're going to see if we can find those very tiny little lion cubs that we had yesterday. We'll have a quick view look in there and see if Mum is there with them. If not, we're going to continue towards Cheetah Plains. I haven't been there for a little while, and I'd like to go and see what's going on in the open clearings. Now, I will show you the post-apocalyptic sky that Brian and I have been observing. Let me just get over this ridge. Of course, there will no doubt be a tree in the way, so it'll be impossible for us to see. Say when, Brian? Probably not too bad. Just have a look there, everyone. And the sun will pop up fairly shortly. So we're as live as Jamie, as I said. Hashtag Safari Live if you want to talk to us on Twitter. Questions at WildEarthTV if you want to talk to us on the email. Either just as good. Obviously, you're limited by characters on tweet. Now, as we sit here, the dawn chorus is very much not a chorus, but to one or two stragglers just tuning their instruments. I can hear a southern black tit going zzzz. Hornbills through the valley of the great Mulwati drainage going otherwise not a great deal. 11 degrees Celsius apparently, 51 Fahrenheit, and those grey clouds that you can see there seem to be a front coming in from the southeast. Right here, look at those sort of ominous smoky clouds there. And our plan now, of course, we're going to keep going slowly towards the east. Penny Pine, you want me to point out a baobab tree sometime during this drive. Penny Pine? There is a very good reason that I will be unable to do that. It's largely because should I drive this vehicle, there are two reasons. Should I drive this vehicle into a position where I could show you a baobab tree, there would be A, no signal, and B, I would be arrested for trespassing. So what happened, or the reason I can't show you a baobab tree, is that they don't extend this south. The extent of their range is to about 50 kilometers to the north of us, maybe slightly less than that, but about 50 kilometers. In the Timbavati, there are two very large examples of baobabs. There are a couple that have been planted on a reserve called Ngala. They're a bit further south of those, and they don't extend further south than that. There are lots up north in the Kruger National Park, and then up into, of course, Mapungubwe, Pafuri, up into Zimbabwe and Zambia, plenty of baobab trees, but none this far south, Penny, so I'm afraid no baobab. Did she say leopard?
She did indeed.
Oh, Jamie has succeeded already.
I have a marvelous surprise for you. Just driving past, the tiniest flick of a little tail alerted me to the presence of two gorgeous little creatures. And I've just found out where Mom is because Herbert has just called it in. This is absolutely wonderful. Herbert's got their Mom. Karula's cubs are playing here in front of us. They're having a marvelous time entertaining themselves, playing gently, keeping each other thoroughly entertained. I would like to introduce to you, if you are joining us for the first time, to Shungile and Hosana. Shungile meaning beautiful and Hosana meaning little prince. And by the way, Hosana can actually be turned into Hosa, which is big prince or big chief. When the little male does grow older, he will have an extraordinary name to match his stature. Ooh. Which one have we got there? It's quite difficult to see, but I think that might be the little male on the left. And they've just got so big. It is absolutely marvelous to see them playing and keeping each other entertained in this way. Hello, guys. We see you. Okay, I'm keeping my voice nice and soft, and as Jandre showed you in the beginning, we're very far away from them since they are without their mum. Peering across the safety of the drainage line at us. What a spectacular way to start off our morning. We've just been so incredibly spoilt with little leopard cub sightings. And they are such well-behaved little children, or little offspring, that Karula has produced. She's told them to stay put, as all mother leopards do, and so they have. For the last 24 hours that they have been all on their own. And those time periods will increase more and more as they get older. They're now 5 months of age. So they're going to be left alone for longer periods of time. Oh, hello. Here's the little girl looking at us. A little bit more independent. Oh, there's your... I want your tail. Bite your ear. See them playing with each other. And just like any kitten or cub, they are full of playfulness and at the same time practicing the hunting skills that they will need in the future. In little movements, that little flick of the tail, anything like that, it immediately attracts their attention and they pounce on it. And as they start to grow a little bit bigger, we're going to see that more and more as they try to catch other little things like squirrels and so on. Hey, you two, when is mommy coming home? If Herbert just got a brief view of Karula, I'm hoping she's heading in this direction to come and fetch them. You can see they're not at all bothered by our presence. We're going to make sure we keep it that way. But what a perfect way to start off our morning. Leopard cubs live from the African bush. Now, Michael, I should have actually gone into this almost immediately once we've spoken about their new names. So we've named them early. Traditionally, leopard cubs only get their names after a year. We've named them early by agreement from all of the lodges as we watch them play. Oh, big brothers pinned sister to the ground. We've named them early to avoid slight confusion that seems to happen because they're some of the most famous leopard cubs in the world. We've named them a little bit early because otherwise that naming process is going to happen automatically. And we're going to have mass confusion. So we've named them a bit early, and Michael wants to know how we spell the names. The name of the male, Hosanna, H-O-S-A-N-A. H-O-S-A-N-A. Shungile, the beautiful one, is currently baring her teeth and her claws at her brother. That is X-O, because the X sound is a sh sound. In Shangan, Shungile, X-O-N-G-I-L-E, X-O-N-G-I-L-E, Shungile. And I think two beautifully suited names. I think Shungile especially, since she really is truly beautiful with her bright brown eyes. Oh, I'm a fearsome predator. I'm a little predator, but I'm a fearsome predator. I'm just going to pop onto the Game Drive channel and make sure that everybody knows this is here. But I'll do that in a moment. We're in no rush just yet. The other guys are still far away. Oh, getting kicked and battered. Oh, standing on each other's face. This is absolutely awesome. Keeping themselves entertained. While they tackle each other. Let's head across to Brent, find out what he's up to, and we'll be back with these little monsters shortly.
We've been looking for Karula. We've got her tracks. I've now just heard a lion calling, not far from where we are, directly to the east. I guess maybe a couple hundred meters. So I think we're going to go look for that. We've been checking. We've got Karula's tracks, but they're from early last night. But there's a lion. It sounds like a male quite close by. My name's Brent. I've got Dangerous Dave the Dish on camera with me. There we go. Giggle to get the camera wobbling. And we've got Herbert on security detail. So very exciting. We always come back to Karula's tracks. But while we've got a lion calling, it's the way to go. So we're going to change our direction. We're going to head straight towards the rising sun, because that's where it sounded like the lion was. So we can see where Herbie is. I know Herbie would have heard it as well. Exciting times. Wouldn't it be fun to have some lions on foot this morning? Of course, this is live. So you are tracking on foot through the African bush, live with myself, the Dish, and Herbie. The Dish, watch out for the tree. And I can see Herbie there. So what we're going to do is we're going to be walking quite quickly to get into that area where we heard the lion. I'd say a couple of hundred meters to the east. So while we race towards those lions, let's go see what the leopard cubs are up to with Jamie.
Now the cubs are playing with each other, keeping each other well entertained. I haven't quite finished chatting to the guys on the Game Drive channel just yet, so bear with me if every now and again I have to pick it up and just decide exactly how we're going to manage the situation. Hey, you two. What you doing? I've lost the other one. I can't see where the other one has gone. Oh, I can see where the other one has gone, but I'm not sure you'll be able to. There we go. Hello, gorgeous. Don't worry. I think Mom's coming back now. I think she's heading back to fetch her cubs, and we are in the perfect position to wait until she does so. Isn't it marvelous how they know for their survival that they must stay in one place until Mom returns? And those survival instincts are incredibly powerful. So if by chance a hyena happened into this area, or a lion for example, they will absolutely be dashing up into the safety of the trees. Well, well. How spoilt are you on this glorious morning out here in the African bush? We've got tiny leopard cubs playing. James has something else very small.
Hello everybody, look at this. We've just come into this area and we just quickly checked if these cubs are here. They are here. Mum is not here, but just listen. The birds are going ballistic. And so I think Mum is not far away. I think she's around here. We're going to sit here for another 2 minutes and see if Mum doesn't pitch up. And if she pitches up, then that's great. Otherwise, we're going to leave them completely be. But can you hear the birds going crazy? I can't see Mum. I can smell. You smell that, Brian? It's quite a strong urine kind of a smell. But I don't know why the birds would be going so insane if there wasn't a lioness around here. Starlings. Starlings really cross. Just down the drainage line there. Now there are four lionesses on Biffle's Hook. Don't know who they are. That's quite a long way from where we are. Well, let's sit here for 2 minutes and see if the mother lioness doesn't come wandering up the top of the drainage land. Oh, isn't this wonderful? I can't believe how lucky we are. And Wendy, you said do birds and squirrels alarm call at these cubs? Wendy, in theory, no, I don't think so. They certainly do. They have started alarm calling at the leopard cubs, but these ones I think are too small. This is unbelievable. It really is very, very special indeed. Just playing gently, fast asleep. Just waking up, trying to stay warm. It's quite chilly, like I said. The birds are going absolutely crazy back there. You hear them. Hornbills, starlings, orioles. Alright everybody, we're going to have to pull out of this sighting. I can't just sit here all day long. I'd love to sit here all day long. And that's simply because it would be slightly unfair. Alright, let's go back to Jamie and the leopard cubs. I'll just assess if the mother isn't here and we'll probably leave shortly. Just wonderful sighting.
Well, we wait to assess the situation with the lion cubs. We're just waiting for Karula to return to her two mischievous little monsters. And Hosana is being stalked by his sister Shungile. And Shungile is going to automatically become Shungi. Can guarantee it. Shungi is going to become her nickname. Just a little pattern of spots hidden behind the trees. I'm going to keep the repositioning down to an absolute minimum, and we can keep our impact on them absolutely minimal. So you'll have to bear with a view that is not sterling, but things will change once a Karula arrives. You know, a wonderful question through from Irek is that perhaps the leopard cubs got a memo from the lion cubs, or that they the memo that they were being upstaged. Because they've never seen them play so much. This is so wonderful, a marvelous sighting, bouncing around, having an absolute whale of a time, keeping each other entertained. And of course it's also their age, that now they are old enough to be playful and coordinated enough to know that they can play safely without having to run away from any potential predators. But you're absolutely right, it is so wonderful to see them play like this in the morning sunlight. I mean, oh, there's my tail. Anything is a toy when you're a leopard cub, including your own tail. And look at that, they are just, now they're like perfect little miniatures of mom. Almost. Maybe a little bit fluffier. Settling down, exploring, getting restless though. I think waiting for mom is starting to take its toll on them. Probably feeling a little bit hungry. But 24 hours is not too long. She could leave them for up to 3 days, although I don't think she's going to. At any moment now, we could hear the call of mom as she reunites with her little ones. She may even have been back here at some point during the night, to come and check up on them, say hello. Where are you going? Where are you off to? That was you, you silly thing. That was you that caused that mudslide. That's so cool. That they feel comfortable enough to even come closer to the vehicles. Or to the vehicle, it's just me at the moment in this sighting. Taking a tumble down into the drainage. Here comes number two. Where did your brother go, little one? What's he up to? Is he full of nonsense? Oh, she's gorgeous. Those brown eyes are just so wonderful. Oh, I'm a hunter. Look at that. Stalking instinct. Come on, girl. You've got the height advantage here. Get him. Get him. Exhibiting every sign of the behavior that will make her a fearsome hunter when she grows up. She's got another year and a half. Well, she's got another year, maybe another year and a half, before she is out all alone, fending for herself. Her brother has a little bit longer. Yes, there we go, get him. Oh, how did he do that? Her brother is an artist at this. He got to the top of the drainage line without me even seeing that. I've lost both of them. Okay. You got her still. There he goes. Now, as I said, we're not going to reposition when we can't see them. We're going to let them come out of the drainage line rather than us down into it. Because if I were to reposition now, I would be way too much in their personal space, and I don't want to do that. Driving on top of a drainage line this steep, it'll make them feel trapped and scared. And Aqua's absolutely right. This is something so exciting for us to look forward to. I'm just sort of watching out of the corner of my eye at the same time. So the more they practice these playful skills of theirs, the better they're going to get at hunting. And very soon, they're going to progress to catching things like lizards, bugs, squirrels, even mongoose. You little nonsenses. Oh, you just disappeared from view. Don't worry, Gendre. We've got... This is awesome. Little tails playing and waving in the drainage. Aqua's right. There's something marvelous about watching little leopard cubs learn to hunt. It's hilarious, first of all, because it often goes very wrong. And then, second of all, it is an extraordinary sighting. So, Aqua, I can't wait either for them to catch their first bug or lizard or whatever it may be. Where'd you go, you two? Have you exhausted each other? While we sit here with Karula's slightly older cubs, much older than the little lion fuzzballs that Brent described as sausages yesterday, Safari Dean has raised a very good point. The big cats of Djuma have left us on babysitting duty. They've left Wild Earth on babysitting duty. I couldn't agree with you more, but you know what? This is the sort of babysitting now. I'm not terribly good with children. But this kind of babysitting, this I can do. And I'm sure everybody here feels exactly the same. We'll keep an eye on them for Karula until she returns. Richard Kennedy, just to go back to what we were talking about before, You wanted to know at what age the little cubs will leave Karula. The females leave sooner than the males. They exhibit sign of independence quicker than the males. She will probably leave Karula at about 18 months of age, possibly up to 2 years, but it's usually around a year and a half up to two. The males will stay a little bit longer. I'm just keeping an eye out on what's going on so that I don't distract you from little heads bobbing up and down every now and again. Males stay a little bit longer, usually up to 2 years, sometimes even 2.5, that they are still revisiting mom and paying, sort of coming to say hello. Oh, look at that. And nobody wants to come and join us for now. We have this. Oh. All to ourselves. How amazing is this? Just blurs of spots battering each other about. So playful. Absolutely wonderful. What have you got there, Jean? Have they popped out there already?
No, they ran up there.
This is crazy. They're all over the place. Right, over to Brent, honey badger.
He's coming back. So sorry about the messiness, but there's a honey badger down in the distance from us. Wait, she's going to come out of the bush now. I've lost sight of him. He's just to the left of screen. So I'm frolicking about. We're in the area where we thought the male lion was, and then suddenly I just spotted this honey badger in the distance. Okay. Just. Can you see him? He's gonna come out. Just go off to the right slightly, please, Dad. There's something. And zoom on the road. Alright, sir. It's a rock. Okay, so just to the left of that marula tree. He's in that little thicket there. Come on. He was right in the middle of the road. Come on, come on, you little. Oh, okay, I think we're going to try to get closer. And hopefully he pops out. But really exciting. We are in the area where we think the male lion is as well. So, unfortunately, he could be just behind us across our eastern boundary. But I'm just trying to make sure that honey badger doesn't pop up again. But let's go see if we can get a bit closer. Sometimes if we go really quietly, and we can do that on a road like this, we can get very close to them. And if we sit down, sometimes they come up and inspect you. To listen as well, because we know there's a lion around here somewhere as well. Okay, so we're gonna go very, very quietly now. So I'm gonna stop speaking for a little bit, just so we can try get another view of this honey badger. Now, honey badgers have a very zigzaggy feeding style, so they don't generally go in one direction. So he could literally pop up anywhere, even attached to Dave's calf, possibly. At the same time, I'm looking for lion tracks. I'm actually looking even close by here, just behind Dave. Even though we saw that honey badger miles down the road. I'm going to stop here quickly. I'm just going to stop and wait and look. But I think he was going more to the northeast. So I'm going to use my stick and I'm going to look into Dave's monitor. So Where's my stick? There we go. That's where he was frolicking about in that area there. Oh, I was hoping he might just pop out. But no such luck yet. Well, we're going to keep moving down here looking for the lion and the honey badger. Wouldn't it be nice to see a lion and a honey badger in the same sighting on foot? Wouldn't that be incredible? Kathy has a very, very good question. Oh, Dave's stuck on a tree. She'd like to know whether honey badgers are like big skunks. Sort of. They do have that very potent anal gland that they are able to spray out of, but they're far bigger than a skunk and much more tough. And they're incredible animals. There's amazing loose skin that enables them to wrestle with lions and all sorts of other big creatures. And most animals try to avoid them for the combination of their toughness and that foul-smelling odor that they can spray out of their anal gland. Now, when I've been tracking by myself on Djuma, I've had a honey badger less than 2 meters from me. I just sat down, he sort of walked up to me and said, he went, "What's that?" and ran off. Now, check carefully. I think he's been going further north, but he fossicks and goes into holes and all sorts of stuff. So while we keep checking for this incredible little beast, let's go back to some equally as incredible little cubs.
Here we go. I've still got the cub. Sorry guys, the signal here is really shaky. I've tried to put myself at a good angle. I'm really hoping to be able to watch with a bone. They've been playing with a vertebra. That's what they've been up to. And they are like little spotted blurs dancing around the drainage line. It is absolutely marvelous. Too cute for words. Here we go. Little girl starting to become more sedate and relaxed. I think they're going to get tired at some point. Oh, no. There's a root to play with. There's the vertebra. Look at that. Sorry guys, I know the signal. But
okay, just behind that branch, it's going to move now. There's actually 3 honey badgers. Come on, pop out. They've gone down a hole. You know, they're still there. Still there. A little bit to the... left corner, there in the middle. Okay, wait. I'm just gonna have a quick look. Dave, come here very slowly to me. Look at it jogging. So there are 3 of them here. Okay, Dave, we're going to sneak up to the termite mound. So come with us. in the middle of frame, zoom. A little bit further. Okay, go to the right, through that gap. The longest honey badger sighting I've ever had on Safari Live, and it's on foot. Now it'll be digging for scorpions, dung beetle larvae, snakes, anything it can find. That one's disappearing. There are another two around. We're gonna sneak up on it now. We're having some success with the sneaking, but it could take us a while. But isn't this incredible? We're gonna try to follow a honey badger on foot. So we're gonna go very slowly. Now remember, there are three. Probably a female and two sub-adults. Let's go look what it was digging at as well. Oh, I think we've been spotted. He saw us. Oh no, there. Come this way. No, he's digging again. Come here. Look, see, there we are. There's one running there. And then, oh, there's three there. I saw two that time, actually. Oh, disappearing. But they're still not too aware of us. Okay, well, I'm going to let them calm down a bit, but let's go have a look what it was digging at. Here we go. So it's been digging all around here. Was this at? Now this looks like it could, from the shape of the hole that's left there, looks like it was trying to dig out a spider. Amazing. Oh, actually, we're a bit closer than I thought. Let's just see where they were going. They're still heading sort of northeast, so we're going to do the same. Just go very slowly. Oh, watch the hole there. Amazing. That is definitely the best honey badger sighting I've had since Safari Live. Normally it's just a dash and into the bush, but well done, Dave. I know it was a difficult one, and we're gonna go back to Jamie and the leopards while we keep trying to track the honey badgers.
I am having probably one of the best times of my entire life just sitting watching these two cubs. They are barreling about the place, entertaining themselves, making everything into a plaything, chasing each other around, getting bored, climbing the walls. They are just the best things in the entire world. Brent's very kindly lent me his camera, so I'm going to take some pictures and see how that works out for me. I'll publish them so you all get an idea of just how revolting my photography skills truly are. But I cannot resist, so apologies for the noise, but hopefully we'll all get to enjoy moments with these little cubs. It's so extraordinary. Now, we have got limited time to spend with them. I've decided that it is because they're alone and because they are relaxed, we are going to make space for another vehicle at some point. Now they will come in a few moments. So these are the last few moments that we've got with the little cubs. We're fine for now. Oh. You little maniacs. This is absolutely marvelous. I've lost them completely. Spotted blurs disappeared in that general direction. Oh, there we go. There's another spotted blur. Now the spotted blurs are climbing a tree, sort of. Oh, and we're going back into the drainage, and it's up the other side. It's Shongile in the lead. That's absolutely wonderful. And of course, we are so fortunate to be... Hey, I'm speaking! Okay, we'll just wait for the arrow-marked babblers to finish their sentence. Right, Rama, when will leopard cubs start to mark their territory? The answer to that is they will start to mark their... Oh, cute, look at them watching the arrow-marked babblers. Okay, I'm distracted. I'll calm down. They start to mark their territory. It depends if they're male or female. When a female gains independence, she almost immediately slots into a territory because her mother hands over a portion of hers. So she'll start marking territory at about 2, 2.5 years old, as soon as she establishes herself. A male has to wait a little bit longer. All right, babblers, I know, you finish your sentence. A male, on the other hand, has to wait until he is big enough to establish his own territory. So young males, what they'll do is they will disperse away from their mothers so that they don't risk inbreeding with their half-sisters or their sisters or their moms. And they will go and establish a territory. But it's only at around, at the earliest 5, although Quarantine, the interesting thing about Karula's son, Quarantine, who at 4.5, he's a big leopard and he challenged his older brother in a way that was quite extraordinary the other day. Sorry guys, I do have to keep listening to the Game Drive channel, so my attention's a bit distracted because there's lots of conversation happening. So there is absolutely a chance that they will start marking at around sort of 5, maybe a little bit older. Oh, we wanted to go for the bird there. Okay, I do need to, sorry, I'll go come back to that question. I do need to get onto the Game Drive channel. In the meantime, we are sending you back somewhere else to show you something else marvelous.
There, everybody, is not quite the highlight of your day, of course. Unbelievable that you've been looking at badgers and leopard cubs and, of course, the tiny baby lion cubs. And that's a kudu eating leaves. I try to say that with a modicum of enthusiasm, and I mean it is a beautiful sighting of a kudu, although it's a little bit in the bush, but goodness, we've had a hell of a morning. And the sun now, Brian, is warming our faces precipitously.
Indeed.
You remember that word that we were taught yesterday, 2 days ago? Apricity?
Apricity.
Do you know what apricity is?
No, I don't.
It is the warmth of the sun upon one's face on a cold winter's day.
Oh, wonderful.
Yes. I am feeling much apricity right now.
Me too.
Yes. Right, we're still on Djuma. Every time I try to get to Cheetah Plains, I seem to find more things here. Well, I mean, I say that as though I've found a great plethora today. But we are now on our far eastern boundary, and we're going to head down the Cheetah Cut Line towards Cheetah Plains and see what's there. There are four lions. They think the Talamati lionesses on Buffalsook right now. So not sure where the Nkuhumas are. They did try and track them last night, apparently, from that buffalo kill that they had. But they weren't there. They didn't manage to find them. I suspect they're probably somewhere on the eastern fringes of, or western fringes of Djuma, or maybe on Simbambili. Right, let's go back to Brent. He's got a track.
since we've seen honey badger, let's carry on with the smaller predators around. And we've got a very interesting track here. Now, you can just make out the three lobes at the back, so it is a cat. But it looks, it's smaller than Karula's cub tracks at the moment. And you can see definitely a little cat, and a nice, really nice way to measure with these things. If we take the gait, which is the length of stride. So let's take this one, draw a line here, like that, right at the back. And then we draw a line there at the next one. And we measure like that with a stick. Break the stick there. There we go. That's how tall, more or less, the serval is at the shoulder. Now, for a small cat, they've got very long legs, and that's this big gaint. Now, that gaint is almost the same length as a leopard like Karula's, but Karula will probably be a little bit longer, a little bit higher at the shoulder. But isn't that fascinating? A serval. Now, we've seen the honey badger. Should we try the near impossible? Should we try track a serval? I think we should. What do you think, Dave? We're going to try track a serval. Now, these tracks are from last night, so it's going to be quite difficult. And I'm sure we'll find lots of fascinating things on the way. But we're going to try track a serval. So I think our luck's running high this morning. We've had honey badger, the longest honey badger sighting I've ever had. So while we track this spotted cat, let's go back to Jamie, who's got other spotted cats.
Imagine if we get a serval on screen as well. Just how extraordinary this morning truly is. I mean, playing leopard cubs, miniature lions, a honey badger or two or three. Absolutely incredible. And these two are still having an absolute ball. They've moved into a slightly more tricky position, but I think most of you will have had some extraordinary screenshots to remember this moment forever, and I think we will remember this moment forever. Every time I come past this drainage line now, I will picture Karula's two little cubs having a marvelous morning, being the most playful I think we've ever seen them. Just incredible. While they wait patiently for Mom to come back. And Jennifer, while we're sitting here, the play, whilst it has been boisterous, positively rambunctious, they are utterly silent. And Jennifer wants to know if they're making any sounds. The only sounds they're making is the rustling of the leaves as they run about, or the sliding of the dirt in the drainage. Otherwise, no, they are totally, totally quiet. And the only time they will make sounds is when Mom decides to come back and join them. Okay, guys, Ephraim is on his way. And when he does arrive, we will pull out. Just bear with me 1 second. Copy that, Ephraim. Let me know when you are at the junction elephant carcass. I'll move out for you. Enjoy the playing of the cubs for the last few moments. Oh, never mind. In that case, don't stress. We don't have to go anywhere just yet. Okay, copy that. No problem. I'll stand by here until you pull in. Marvelous. Ephraim's decided he's not coming straight here. He's going to check for Mom first. Mom, it appears, is wandering south towards Gowrie, Maine. Ah. Oh. Battering each other with their tails. And Arcadia, if Karula successfully raises these two cubs to adulthood, and I have to say, I am very positive about that. I think she has the most marvelous success record with little cubs. Arcadia would like to know if the if Shungile will share part of Karula's territory. Hosanna was dominant in an area. You were all very quick with your screenshots there because that was absolutely incredible. Gentle touch. Sorry about that dip in screen. And luckily for us, we have managed to stay with the covers for just longer to give you this glorious view. Little Shungile with George at the back. No, his name is George. His name's Hosanna. James. That's all James's fault. Habit. Habit's become a... Hosanna and Shungile enjoying the last rays of the morning sun, and we're going to have to leave them very, very soon. So let us just enjoy this marvelous glance of this cute little thing staring off into the sun. They've relaxed a lot. They are just, I think, sunbathing for now, waiting for mommy, and also listening carefully to an advancing herd of elephants that are on their way in this direction. So we're going to be leaving them very soon. They'll be absolutely fine. The elephants are not a threat to them. They might chase them, but they won't chase them far. Such a gorgeous view. Absolutely marvelous. A truly special, very memorable morning in terms of time spent with some of our most beloved new arrivals to Djuma. We have been incredibly spoiled. Okay, I need to call Ephraim in to the sighting, so we are going to leave in a moment. I'm just listening to, waiting for the conversation to end so that I can hop on the Game Drive channel. The guys have found the Nkuhumas, or the Telemartes, it hasn't been clarified. They found some lionesses and Buffleshook. Are they just giving some directions there? Are you going to go up the tree? What are you thinking? Yes, no? No. I'm just going to sit here and look beautiful. I actually never finished the conversation about leopard ages at which they start to mark their territory. And I apologize to Michael. He got so severely distracted by gremlins and other things. We spoke about the females, but the males we never fully qualified. So it depends on the male. It's usually around 6 years old that they start to establish themselves a territory. They might do it at a little bit of a younger age if, for example, there's a vacuum of large males in that area, if they find themselves a good spot where there isn't a large male in attendance, then they will start to mark territory a little bit earlier. Oh, such a big yawn. Very tiring thing, spending your morning galloping about like little maniacs. Sometimes you need to just sit and relax. And she's blinking sleepily in the sun. I think she's going to go and fall asleep. Her son at the back, wriggling around every now and again, just that flash of movement on the right of your screen. His sister looking dignified. Such a wonderful sighting. So what we'll do when we do leave is we will go and we will find Karula. Ooh, that actually might be... Let's just hold off for one moment. There you go, Shamsun, who's observant, listening to alarm-calling birds. You're wondering if they're alarm-calling at Karula? I don't think so. I'm listening very carefully, but Shamsun, I don't think that they are alarm calling at her. If it was a leopard, they would be doing it more. I think at the moment that's just a relaxed contact call between Cubs. In the meantime, let's go over to Brent, who has some impala on foot.
So there we go, we're viewing impala across a little riverbed and in a timbuerchi thicket. And isn't that beautiful? You just see the dappled light coming through onto those male impala. Unfortunately, we lost the serval tracks over a rocky section, so we decided to come check down one of my favorite areas of the whole of Djuma, and it's an area that's best explored on foot. There's lots of spots you can't even get a car into here. And there we go, the impala moving off. So if we look up back to the east, we're on this massive game path and utilized by lots of different animals. I mean, we've had kudu tracks, waterbuck tracks, hyena, old leopard tracks, honey badger tracks, white-tailed mongoose tracks, janitor tracks, impala tracks, diker tracks, stenbok tracks. So there's a lot going on in this area. And we're on our way to one of my favorite trees on the whole of Djuma. Hopefully, I'm not going to fall out of this one. And it'll stay one of my favorites, unlike the Balanites. And Herbert's wandering around ahead, seeing if he can find any little critters. Unfortunately, that lion we heard roaring was to the east of us in Torchwood. And look, here we go, we've got a nice little spot where the elephants have been feeding up ahead here. You can see how they've manhandled this bush willow. Oh, not a bush willow, sorry, weeping wattle. I mean, look at that. That elephant's just ripped this branch off. And it's not light. I mean, look at that. The side of my hand fits in there. And this is not a small branch. And that shows you how incredibly powerful the elephants are. This is probably yesterday by the look of things here. And looking at it, I think this is just, it's a single elephant from the tracks. It's not multiple. So probably a young bull. And he's spent some time absolutely destroying this weeping wattle. Now, weeping wattle has the softest and most lovely of leaves. That's why it's sometimes called a toilet paper tree. Also, you can make a mattress out of it if you have to stay in the bush for a long period of time. And also a good indicator of where there's underground water. Now, of course, if you're stranded, you're not going to be able to dig down to where the water is. What I'd do if I was stranded, I'd head down to the Moati River and start digging in the sand there. Even if it took me half a day, I would eventually get to water, and that's what would keep me alive out here. Oh, Herbie's found something. Let's go see what Herbie's found. What have we found, Herb? Oh, very interesting stuff here. Okay, so we're going to get down and dirty. And got to be a bit careful. Oh, these are, I know, give Jamie the heebie-jeebies. And they are incredibly venomous little creatures. Can you see them, Dave? Look at that coloration, that sort of baby blue legs. And ferocious little hunters. Now, being a centipede, he's got one leg per body segment, and a millipede will have two, sometimes even three in abnormal cases. But look at the colors of this little centipede. Now, they live under logs, so Herbie's turned over a log to expose him, and normally they'll come out at night and hunt for little insects. And even the really big centipedes have been recorded taking mice and little rodents. Now, if they bite you, they've got cytotoxic venom, so it'll cause necrosis. So your skin will actually start rotting around the bite site. But that is not the only fascinating little critter that is under this particular log. And there's a very strange spider. And I'm going to have to ask Steph about this spider because I don't think I know what it is. So if we have a look up here, yeah, look at that. I'm pretty sure it's a spider. So I'm not sure what spider this is. So grab some screenshots, send them to me, and I'll try identify it when I get home and maybe ask Steph for some help. But while we continue to search for little and big critters out on foot, let's go back to Jamie for one last look at Karula and the cubs.
One last look at just the cubs. I know I keep saying that to you, and I'm sorry to sort of get your hopes up and then dash them, or vice versa, or you guys preparing not to see them anymore, and then we're still here. Just because we're waiting for Ephraim, who's checking very carefully for Karula. Right, I've officially filled up Brent's memory card. He's going to be very chuffed with me. That's okay. I think he did lend me his camera. Of course, now they're being utterly adorable in the open, in full sunlight. But nevertheless, that is just the way things are. Please take lots of screenshots, since I've now can no longer take any more photographs. They are absolutely just the best, most photogenic creatures you have ever seen. They are absolutely marvelous. I think this has been my best leopard cub sighting ever. And I feel like I say that every time we go and see these two. But it really, I'm not exaggerating, it really has truly been extraordinary. We are so fortunate to be in this position. Hosanna has found himself something at the back there, a stick of some kind. Shungile now resting after her brotherly tackle. I can't believe how fortunate we've been, the amount of time we've got to spend with these animals. Oh, I'm thinking about hunting little brother, or big brother, twin brother. Can you believe we're watching leopard cubs play live from the middle of the African bush? Admittedly, with one or two problems every now and again. But needless to say, we've been given an insight into the way that these creatures grow and learn and play in a way that I think is unparalleled. You might get a shot or two like this in a documentary, maybe a documentary about the life of a leopard, but this is live, this is unedited, and certainly unscripted. I feel as though it's the best way to watch and to learn about the wildlife in this area. You will always be able to picture what a 5-month leopard looks like, 5-month old leopard. And my deep and profound conversation is being lost to gremlins every now and again. We will just enjoy these moments of peace. You know, I haven't moved. Every time my signal disappears, it just is what it is. Ephraim. Ephraim's gone AWOL. He's disappeared. Perhaps he is off the vehicle tracking. This may or may not be the last view of the cubs. Oh, somebody's got a pile of elephant dung just for fun. I don't know. We're going to go, while I chat on the Game Drive channel, we're going to go over to... Where are we going, Kirsten? Sorry.
James.
James. I don't know what's my hearing today. Let's go to James and see what he's up to.
Hello everybody, I've been working at this for about an hour now. Now my dad said to me once that he was a Boy Scout, and one of the badges that they got in Boy Scouting was the axe badge. And what you got to do to get your axe badge was hit the piece of wood in the same place, and then the tree would be felled within seconds. I have hit this tree once in the same place, and thousands of times in other places. You have arrived. Oh, I see. I could probably have just pulled it out of the way. Look at that, Brian. That's actually unbelievable. I've been standing here for about 15 minutes, hacking away with a blunt machete. Absolutely useless. Oh well. At least I'm now warm. Well, your morning continues to be absolutely unbelievable. Karula, I believe, has made her way back to her babies. Whether she's managed to find them anything to eat or not, I suppose, remains to be seen. Doesn't seem like it. We're on Cheetah Plains, the normally completely immaculate state of the roads here, disturbed by the elephants. I can hear some elephants up ahead shouting at each other, so we'll see if we can find them. We're just sort of three in a row pans over that way, and we are on our way to the actual open areas there to see what we can find. Oh, Ryan, that was a complete waste of time, wasn't it? Absolute waste of time. Unbelievable. Well, at least I'm warm and my hands have got blisters on them now. I definitely hit that tree in the same place twice, out of at least 4,000 or 5,000 attempts with a very blunt machete. Poor me.
Woe is James.
Woe is me. What I also forgot to do there was have a taste. Because the taste of, that was a red thorn tree. The taste of the bark, the inner bark of the red thorn is delicious. Sorry about that, Brian. No, I'm sure you are. I don't blame you for being disappointed. Yeah. What was that? Sorry. I will continue my wafflings later on. Let's go back to the cubs.
We're still here with... disappointed that I have to stay here until he arrives, but that would be a lie, as you can imagine. Any moment spent with these precious, despite the fact that our signal keeps disappearing. So we're going to be here until we have to leave, essentially. And we're just chatting about, there's no want in this scenario. Oh, hello, look at this, watch this. Look at the Franklin. This Franklin's about to get such a fright. Oh, or not. Missed your opportunity, little cub. Ooh, anticipation building. The unsuspecting crested Franklin marching straight up to the cub. Oh, three unsuspecting crested Franklins. Cubs are interesting. They generally don't go for birds like this, and it's because the amount of noise that would result in terms of alarm, calls of alarm and frantic screeching. But you never know. These cubs are young and inexperienced. Are they going to try and tackle a Franklin? They might be a little bit too big. Where'd the cub go? Lost it. Okay. There we go. Still a little spotted shadow. He completely hidden. Those birds had no idea that leopard cub was there. Not a clue. They've left now. So obviously the little leopard cub not quite brave enough just yet to tackle something of the size of a Franklin or a Spurfowl. Moment of sheer excitement. Still watching, still curious, but not yet brave enough to launch an attack. And probably sensible. Oh. Sibling, on the other hand, is a very different story. But definitely a sensible approach, because the screech of the Franklin could attract unwanted attention. And Crinata, just in terms of watching them, you want to know how I'm telling the cubs apart. The answer is they have a really clear distinct size difference at the moment. The boy is much, much larger than the girl. And the girl has the most extraordinarily brown eyes. They are, I don't know how I would describe them, they're actually chocolate brown. I have never seen eyes like that on another leopard before in my life. The little female, brown eyes, the little male, sort of bluish, yellowish, brownish eyes. There you go, there's the best colour description ever. I'm sure there's a name for a colour like that. So, male big, in bluish eyes, female tinier, brownish eyes. If we want to go into great detail, we can talk about the different spot patterns. Their spot patterns are unique. Every leopard's spot patterns is like their fingerprint. It stays the same throughout their lives, and it is completely unique to it.
Spotted the Franklin.
Awesome. What's going to happen next? We await the moment in suspense. There's the Franklin. How brave are our cubs?
Funnily enough, I think that might be the male cub. I'm not 100% sure. But funnily enough, it would be more likely that the female would start to practice hunting first. And I mentioned that they become independent sooner, and they show signs of... There you go. For those of you who were eagerly anticipating the cub's first hunt, you might just have witnessed it. One very unsuccessful attempt at catching a Franklin and some very confused and somewhat terrified Franklins disappearing off. Did you miss by any chance, little one? I'm not laughing at you, I promise. Promise. And as hilarious as those first bumbling attempts truly are, it's going to be what turns them into the fearsome predators that they will one day become. Oh, there's some very cross Franklins. Indignant. Oh, the cub's going again. Cheeky little monsters. Certainly keeping themselves thoroughly entertained. Well, since they have now disappeared off, we've spoken about practice making perfect. Let us find out if Brent's tree climbing skills are, I was going to say have improved any, I think he'd be a little bit upset by that. If his tree climbing skills are, Franklin flying off, if his tree climbing skills are as marvelous as they always are.
So I'm basking in my favorite tamboti tree, and as you can see, I've decided not to move too far from the ground. Now, this is on top of a nice big termite mound, and these multiple stems all around me are all from the same tree, and I think this is probably the biggest tamboti tree on the whole of Djuma. Probably close on 800 years old. It is an absolutely magnificent tree and far from the beaten track, and the only way to really get here is on foot. Now, while we've been basking in the sun, warming up from the chilly morning, I have heard some elephants in that direction, so we're probably going to see if we can get a view of them as we sneak along the edge of this little river system. I just want to take another moment, and Dave's going to give you a tour of the tree from below now, and you can just see how spectacular and big it is, because remember, I'm not a small human. And these multiple trunks of this massive tamboti. And if only it could tell stories, I'm sure it's seen its fair share of action and adventure just being stationary here. Now it's actually between two massive game pods, so I'm sure lots of different creatures have passed under this particular tree. Okay, so I'm gonna have a quick walk down this path here. Now the elephants sound like they're probably not more than 50 or 60 meters away. I'm going to see if we can get a view from this side of the river first before we go across, because if we can get a view of the elephants, and I'm going to show you why it would be the perfect spot to view elephants from as we come across here. So this is a little tributary of the Mwati, and you can see how deep it is here. Now the elephants sound like they're over there somewhere, but they do sound like they're on the move. So I can't get a visual from here. So we are going to sneak further to the south and see if we can get any visual there. Now, this drop here next to me is probably around 15 foot. Okay, you can see. Gabriella would like to know, what is my favorite thing about exploring the outdoors? I think it's finding the unexpected, Gabriella. Like that honey badger this morning. We were rushing to try find a male lion, and all of a sudden we found not one but three honey badgers. I think finding the unexpected is always incredible. Like those little creatures under the log. Now there's a spider I've never seen before, and I'm quite excited to go try to figure out which spider it is. I'm going to have to help Dave through this particularly thick little section, because he's obviously got a big aerial on top of him. So let's go this way, Dave. I think this is going to be the easiest way. So while I help Dave get through here, let's go see what Commander Bond's been up to.
Haven't found a great deal, I have to tell you, here at Cheetah Plains. It's a very pretty morning, sorry, not afternoon yet. That's after 12 o'clock, isn't it, Brian? Yes. We thought we saw an elephant here, but it turned out to be a shiny tree. But there, everyone, is a red-billed hornbill. Can you see it, Brian? Yes. And it is enjoying the apricity of the morning in the same way that we are. There is no bird that enjoys apricity more than a hornbill. Always you will find them on the trees soaking up the first rays of the sun. There it is next to us, Brian. It's over there. It's eating amongst the... Sorry about that. It is eating amongst the buffalo dung. We're picking out termites largely, I think. Termites love the buffalo dung and the elephant dung at this time of the year especially. And the hornbills in turn love the termites. As I was saying the other day, despite the fact that it is clearly very dry and there's seemingly not a great deal of life around, you wonder what on earth these birds are eating. Well, clearly there's enough, because the birds don't look so skinny. They look to be doing just fine. So clearly there is plenty of invertebrate life for them to be eating, and I suspect it's largely made up of termites at this time of the year. And I know that the aardvark, for example, an ant bear, although they're known for eating termites, they eat ants quite a lot during the summertime, but in the winter they tend to move on to the termites. And as we know, termites make up, just listen carefully to what I'm going to say here, the termite species living under the ground are a greater biomass than the above-ground herbivores. That means that all the elephants, all of the 9 species of antelope that we have here, the warthogs, the rhino, the hippopotamus, and everything else you can think of that eats a piece of grass or a piece of leaf, make up less mass than the mass of the termites living under the ground. And so there are a truly astonishing number of those termites under the ground, and that is what is sustaining these red-billed hornbills, yellow-billed hornbills, quite a few of the barbets, the rollers, and all the other insect-eating birds that have to overwinter here. There's a wind blowing from the southeast and a bit of a front blowing in, and I suspect quite strongly that we're going to have a slightly nasty afternoon of blustery conditions. Right, well, I can hear some crowned lapwings shouting in the clearings to the southeast. Let's head down there and see if we can find something other than a shiny tree that looks a little bit like an elephant from a great distance. Ah, now, James Richard, you say maybe we'll see some ground hornbills. Well, we did hear some when I was hacking away very ineffectually at that tree. We did hear some ground hornbills. Brian, what did they sound like? Exactly, just like that. That is a quite astonishing ability that Brian has to make the sound of the ground hornbill. There are some elephant tracks here. They're not very new and they're going the other way. It's pretty irritating. Let's go around the